119, which was and we are going to discuss the answers. So we asked you, based on the photograph provided in the case, that what is your diagnosis of this particular lower limb lesion of a young diabetic who is not that well controlled. So if you closely look at the picture of the lower limbs, you'll see these lesions marked out with yellow arrows. And they are present on both legs. And if you closely observe, they are along the saphenous vein, great saphenous vein track. And the description which was given was very straightforward, that this is a cord-like, tender, and erythematous-looking lesion. And photograph showed exactly along great saphenous vein. So this was superficial venous thrombosis with some inflammation. So few doctors said this is a migratory superficial thrombophlebitis, which was close to the answer, but it is not migratory because this was only one lesion and did not show at other places. And the history did not suggest any migration of the lesion. So the diagnosis was superficial venous thrombosis. Now superficial venous thrombosis, some literature also say or include this entity under superficial venous thrombophlebitis also. So it's a similar term, but we prefer to call it superficial venous thrombosis. Now this was the Doppler report of this patient, and this clearly showed it was a thrombosis of the right long saphenous vein and also left long saphenous vein. And some of the right short saphenous vein was also thrombosed. So this was extensive superficial vein thrombosis in a uncontrolled diabetes mellitus young patient. Now, why this case is important? Because we often miss these cases in outpatient because of either we are not very much aware of this entity because we don't see this common, and we always tend to look for deep vein thrombosis, which is supposedly more common among practitioners. So this was the follow-up of the case. So this was his initial lesions. You can see very well along the saphenous vein. And this is another on the right leg, and this is on the left leg. And this was a follow-up photograph after 1 month. You can see that the erythema is gone on the left leg. What is remaining is a hyperpigmentation and remaining discoloration of the long saphenous vein. Today, he came with a follow-up venous Doppler, for which we wanted to see any deep vein thrombosis and resolution of remaining superficial vein thrombosis. So there was no DVT of any kind in both the legs, and we stopped his anticoagulant. So we are going to see how do we treat this case, and what are the current guidelines, and what are the diagnostic challenges in these patients. So as I said, superficial vein thrombosis or thrombophlebitis means the same thing. So it appears as a painful erythematous cord-like palpable structure, and predominantly you'll see this presentation in lower extremities, but it can affect any superficial vein in the body. Some of you might be aware of Maunder's disease, which is a thrombosis of the thoracic veins around breast, and it can also involve other superficial veins in the body. So this is not very specific to lower limb, but it is commonly seen in outpatient in great saphenous vein. Now, is it a benign condition? Should we treat or we should not treat? Or we just leave it with analgesic? But previously, it was thought that it is a benign self-limiting condition, but this is not so. A lot of studies have showed that there could be concomitant deep vein thrombosis associated with superficial venous thrombosis. Even pulmonary embolism is associated with this SVT. And there is a significant risk of developing venous thromboembolism. Those who had history of SVT have 4 to 6-fold increased risk of developing further a pulmonary embolism or deep vein thrombosis. And superficial thrombi are much longer in extent than clinically presumed. So even if you see clinically in outpatient with the hand, you can palpate the thrombus, but actual extent may be even larger on a Doppler. So these are some of the important things that you need to know about SVT, superficial venous thrombosis. What is the incidence? Previously, it was thought that it is most commonly associated with varicose veins and the incidence is very less, but it's not the case. Many studies show that many cases go unreported and the actual incidence may be very high. In few studies, females showed higher incidence. There is a huge recurrence rate of 18 to 42% and associated concomitant DVT and pulmonary embolism in these patients. So this is very important clinical entity not to be taken lightly, and it is definitely not self-limiting or benign condition. As we saw in our case, usually the long and short saphenous veins of the legs are involved. So this is the common site. Upper limbs can be also involved. And abdominal walls, breast, as I said, Mondor's disease. The risk factors of superficial venous thrombosis are similar to that of deep vein thrombosis. So malignancy, postoperative period, obesity, mobility, they are all common, OC pills. But there is a one risk factor which we need to keep in mind on SVT, that it is commonly associated with varicose veins. So how do we diagnose? Should we diagnose only based on clinical appearance, just feeling the thrombus because it is superficial? Yes, you can definitely say that there is a probable SVT on clinical examination, but you need to take it further in diagnosis with duplex ultrasonography. So whenever you find a painful, firm, palpable cord with inflammation and tenderness, if associated with edema, then you should entertain this diagnosis of SVT. So as I said, duplex ultrasound imaging, compression ultrasound imaging is the key investigation that we asked in the question. So this is the only investigation that is important in this patient. Of course, if the patient gets recurrent superficial venous thrombosis, then you have to have complete thrombophilia evaluation of the patient. Now, whether to treat or not to treat, this question is arising because many of the times the old literature says it is a self-limiting benign disease, and because it is superficial, it may not be dangerous. But as we discussed in previous slides, there is a real risk of pulmonary embolism or associated deep vein thrombosis. So which cases are to be treated and which are not to be treated? So this answer to this question is not as easy as asking for DVT, because the literature about DVT is very clear with American College of Chest Physician guidelines on how to treat deep vein thrombosis. But there is little controversy and little disagreement about how to treat superficial venous thrombosis. So we are going to see these differences. So the key points which are considered in formulating treatment of superficial venous thrombosis is, What is the location of the thrombosis? What is the length, the thrombus length we are talking about in SVT? Whether there is an associated DVT or not? And what are the presence of other risk factors? So these four key factors are taken into account in deciding whether to treat the patient or not. So what treatment options we have? Standard is unfractionated heparin or low molecular weight heparin, and followed by oral anticoagulant therapy as we do in DVT. But we can also give non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs if the inflammatory component is troublesome to the patient. There is a scope for in some patients about surgery, that's ligation or stripping of the involved vein. And of course, ancillary therapies like elastic stockings can be utilized. We'll see each one of them. Now, if you have a patient who has above knee superficial venous thrombosis of saphenous vein, and if it is within 3 centimeters of saphenofemoral junction involving some of the deep venous system, then there is consensus about treating with heparin or oral anticoagulants, the warfarin, the old drug, and newer oral anticoagulants. So there is no question about this group of superficial venous thrombosis. But if you don't have these and only superficial venous thrombosis but no DVT, there is no consensus. So how do we treat this remaining category? Now, if you have a thrombus length which is more than 4 to 5 centimeters, and location which is more than 3 centimeters from saphenofemoral junction, then few societies and few institutes advocate use of therapeutic anticoagulation. So one study demonstrated efficacy of fondaparinux 2.5 milligram for 45 days or low molecular weight in heparin in intermediate dosages for 4 to 6 weeks. And there was a small trial on rivaroxaban which showed non-inferiority with fondaparinux. So this is one group which we can treat. But there is also a category which is a low risk SVT with a thrombus length which is less than 4 to 5 centimeters, location more than 3 centimeters from saphenofemoral junction, and those patients can be treated only with NSAIDs for 8 to 12 days. In this group of patients, usually the institutes and different organizations say anticoagulation may not be considered. But of course, we have to judge clinically each case on its own merits. Something about ancillary treatment, we can give this to all patients. Topical treatment with diclofenac gel for relieving erythema, pain, and compression stockings, which should be class 2, which give pressures up from 23 to 32 millimeter of mercury for 3 weeks. So there are different types of compression stockings, and I have given a chart here for guidance, which compression stockings are to be used in which conditions. Not all compression stockings are same, and they are not used for all indications. So what we look in superficial venous thrombosis is these two group between 20 to 30 millimeters of mercury. These are the compression stockings you should be using in these patients. So most of the times, if you prescribe just elastic stockings and the patient goes to the surgical shop and he buys any stockings, it is of not use. You have to specify which type compression pressure in prescribing elastic stockings. Then otherwise the patient will not use because it will not be efficacious. If you prescribe something with very strong compression as required in lymphedema or severe chronic venous insufficiency, the patient may feel uncomfortable and not required for superficial venous thrombosis. And if you can't prescribe something which is a very light pressure, less than 20 millimeter, which is used only for prevention of DVT or mild edema and tired aching legs in occupational leg symptoms. So you have to be careful about which compression stockings you need to prescribe. Now we treated this patient with rivaroxaban. The reason why we treated with rivaroxaban, after going through different guidelines, our patient was unique. It was not a unilateral superficial venous thrombosis. It was bilateral and multiple as per the venous Doppler report. And he had a diabetes which was not very well controlled. He was a male, which is a risk factor for superficial venous thrombosis recurrence. And he has a past history of poor compliance with his insulin injections, follow-up. He would never do his sugars on time and come for follow-up quickly, even if his sugars go high. So because of these follow-up issues, we did not want this patient to be just left untreated with NSAIDs and difficult to monitor for development of DVT or pulmonary embolism. So only for this patient, we started this patient on the rivaroxaban. So let's see something about rivaroxaban, that it is used for treatment of DVT and pulmonary embolism, but there is also one good trial on superficial venous thrombosis. The dose is 15 milligram twice a daily with food up to 21 days. This is a loading dose, and from 22 days onwards, you have to prescribe 20 milligrams once daily with food. The best thing about rivaroxaban is not much of dose change is necessary up to moderate CKD, but some reduction may be needed in patients who have severe reduction in their GFR. And if the GFR is less than 15 ml per minute, it is not recommended. So these patients are at high risk of bleeding. So usually this is a very good drug for outpatient treatment. And another advantage is you don't have to overlap with heparin, or you don't require the patient to be pre-treated with heparin for either a DVT or superficial venous thrombosis. So this becomes a very ideal drug for outpatient management. So we prescribed this patient rivaroxaban because getting twice a day heparin for that patient was difficult because he's a serving patient and usually on a transfer duty. So we chose rivaroxaban. There are important differences regarding SVT and DVT. That SVT is more frequent than DVT in clinical settings. D-dimer test may be falsely negative because the clot burden in superficial venous thrombosis is less than that of in DVT. So D-dimer may come falsely negative. So you can't rely on this test. The mortality, although it is less, it can still progress to DVT and PE, as opposed to DVT, where the mortality is higher and also the incidence of pulmonary embolism. So I come to the close of the case. These are the clinical pearls of the case of superficial venous thrombosis, that whenever you get such lower limb lesions or anywhere in the body along known venous track, erythematous cord-like lesion, think about superficial venous thrombosis. The risk factors and complications are similar to DVT. You should not think that it is a benign disease and self-limiting disease. Think about anticoagulation in appropriate clinical presentation. Treat SVT which are near to the saphenofemoral junction and with a longer thrombus length with therapeutic anticoagulation. So this is how we can summarize how to treat this case and how to diagnose. If you are interested, we can read more on this. We have one article, review article from Journal of Thrombosis and Hemostasis, which is uploaded in the digital library of CGHS clinics, which you can refer if you want to read more on this. there was similar case like ours was appeared in Images in Clinical Medicine of New England Journal of Medicine in 2001, which was also a similar presentation and treated with therapeutic anticoagulation. We have much better picture than this case, and our case was a bilateral presentation. So I stop here and I open the forum for discussion. If there are any questions, please ask. Doctors can share their experience of their own cases of superficial venous thrombosis, how they treated it, any different presentation, any different therapeutic guidelines they followed.